آزادی بیان
یعنی لون زیو
Free speech. Jutta Clausen, tell me about the conversation in a Boston hotel on the 23rd of July 2009 when Yale University Press told you that they would not publish the already prepared sheaf of illustrations to your book about the cartoons that shook the world.
Linda Lorimer, the vice president of Yale University, was there, as well as John Donatich, the editor of the press, and the head of the Islamic Studies program had also at Yale University had also traveled to Boston to meet with me. And Linda Lorimer was stressing that there were foreign policy risks and started talking about various important people who had said that there was a serious risk associated with publishing the cartoons. Then it became gradually clear also that they weren't going to just withdraw the Danish cartoons, which was something I agreed to on the condition that we get a statement inside the book that recognized that the censorship had occurred. But then it became very slowly clear that they were planning to remove all of the illustrations, also illustrations, a copy of a picture from an Ottoman manuscript of Muhammad riding out into war together with Ali. And the arguments were that there would be a personal risk to myself. I was asked if I wasn't concerned about my own safety, since depicting Muhammad constitutes blasphemy in Pakistan and could potentially be punished by death. Wouldn't I be afraid there would be a death sentence executed upon me? Didn't I worry about my children? I was even brought in my children. But at that point, I just thought that we had made an arrangement, an agreement that the illustrations show the reproduction of the newspaper page with the 12 cartoons was going to be removed, which I agreed to, and on the condition that we have this statement in the front of the book. So at that moment when I walked out, I thought that was the arrangement. And then in the following days, I was then told that, in fact, wouldn't I voluntarily agree to remove all of the illustrations that Yale University had developed, a 15-page dossier with statements from various government officials and others detailing the security risk, not just to Yale and the press and my own life, but also to American foreign policy in general.
Now, did you see the 15-page dossier?
I was, I would be allowed to see it. The answer is no, I did not see it. The condition under which I would be allowed to see it was that I agreed that we would not have the statement marking that illustrations had been removed. I would get to see the statement only on the precondition that I had that there would be no statement anywhere in the book that the illustration had been removed, which I refused to do.
So the condition on which they would let you see the expertise was that there should be no acknowledgement in the book that this deal had been made.
That's right.
That's an extraordinary condition.
It was. It was clearly the case that they much preferred that nobody would know ever. And so it's an effort to make me not even have this court interview that I'm having with you right now. I was expected to sign a statement. I would say that I would never mention it had happened.
So you've never seen the so-called experts document, but from what they told you, this was as much about possible threats to U.S. national interests and foreign policy interests as about any direct threat of violence.
That's correct.
What do you think Yale University, and as I understand it from this account, it was as much, it was the university itself, not just the press. What other considerations do you think were foremost in their mind?
Well, Linda Lorimer, the vice president, was speaking when we met about how she traveled to Saudi Arabia and Gulf states, and that possibly there could be risks to, she said she wasn't afraid, but there could possibly be risk to the university, etc., and to students. We're not concerned about students who might be penalized. I remember mentioning that I didn't think that Yale University perhaps was quite as important as that. And then she said, no, no, it'd be extraordinarily important, it's as important as the state. So clearly, there was an inflated sense of Yale's own importance, conflating Yale's interest with national interests, as well as also a real effort to just plainly scare me.
And what's your judgment? Because the statement, the publisher's statement that appears in the book says, I quote, "The overwhelming judgment of the experts was that the republication of the cartoons by Yale University Press ran a serious risk of instigating violence." Unquote.
Yes.
It's a very odd use of the word instigating.
Yes. Well, Yale University found itself in a dilemma because Yale University, as too many other universities, have statements saying that you are not allowed to censor speech out of consideration for the feelings of others. So therefore, the only way that they could justify the censorship was by saying that there was a serious risk. They couldn't justified on grounds of a crossing offence.
Now, Jutta Clausen, you are a leading expert on the nexus between Islam or Islamism and violence. Do you think at that point, several years after the height of the cartoon controversy, do you think there was a serious risk of another round of violence being, in some sense, occasioned by the book?
There were never any threats. There was never any threatening mail. There was no empirical evidence of any threat. When I traveled as part of the research for the book, I was actually traveling with the Danish cartoons, a reproduction of the Danish cartoon, not just those, but also a folder produced by a group of Danish imams and mosque activists to rile up opinion in Egypt and in the Middle East. And one of the imams I knew, and he had given me a copy of the dossier. So I traveled with that when I went to Azerbaijan. I interviewed the Secretary General of the Organization of the Islamic Conference, Isanulu, and I went to Cairo with it, and I showed it, and I told everybody, I'm going to print these cartoons in my book when it comes out. What do you think of that? And people said, yes, please. We were never the cartoons themselves. We were always just demonstrating about the issue was what they said about who Muslims are and what Muslims think. It wasn't, depiction was never an issue. So my book actually explains that in great detail. So it was a paradox to have the foreword to sort of turn against the even citing evidence of violence, some of the statistics I have in my own book, where I argue that yes, there was violence in Nigeria. It wasn't because of the cartoons, but it was because there was already pre-existing conflicts and hot flash points there between Christians and Muslims. So the statement actually turns around and distorts the argument of my book.
So, briefly, you don't actually think there was a serious probability of violence against you or people associated with Yale? But
no.
If they had published a book with these illustrations.
No.
So you think the decision was the wrong one?
Yes, I do.
Now let's explore that a bit more, because, of course, the other side of the story is the question why it was so important to have that sheaf of illustrations, which started with a reproduction of the whole page of Jyllands-Posten, showing all the different cartoons, not just the one with the bomb, and went on to have a number of other historical depictions of the Prophet. I understand from an interview you gave to Index on Censorship that no less than 4 academic reviewers of the book had supported your view that these images should be included?
Yes. This is an academic press. The book was reviewed, was sent before the Publications Committee at Yale University. The Publications Committee, consisting of faculty at Yale, had passed and accepted the book, even put into their notes that it was important that these illustrations would be included.
The Publication Committee said it was important that they be included?
Yes.
On what grounds?
The purpose of the chapter is to describe the history of depicting Muhammad in Islamic art and in Western Christian art traditions, as well as also explaining the differences and the different meanings of the cartoons and how Danes would read them and why they, in fact, would be offensive to Muslims. Because there's a great deal of ambiguity about what they actually mean. And some of the 12 cartoons very clearly showed that criticisms of the newspaper and saying that Muslims were the victims in this matter. So it was, my purpose was educational. It was certainly not to provoke. Mm.
And the result is that in a book called The Cartoons That Shook the World, the one thing we can't see is the cartoons that shook the world.
That's correct. People sometimes tell me, why does it matter? You can still see them online. But the problem with many of the reproductions online is that they take the cartoons out of the context. So many people actually don't realize how exactly they were reproduced, the whole nature of the exercise by the Danish newspaper. Nor do people really understand that many of the cartoonists had other opinions than the one being expressed by Vestergaard's iconic depiction of Muhammad with a bomb in a turban.
So one of our draft principles on the free speech debate website is there should be no taboos in the discussion and dissemination of knowledge. What we have here is the enforcement of a taboo.
Yes, and it's not even a widely shared taboo. It is a taboo that is being asserted only by the extreme political sections of the Islamist movement, as well as certain religious groups. It's not a universally shared taboo. Self-evidently not, since we have a terrific Ottoman art depicting Muhammad. So one of the problems with what has happened is that Yale's actions reinforced the views of those extremists, namely that you cannot depict these cartoons, so you cannot depict the images.
Now, can I just go to that point of reinforcing? Because another of our draft principles says we neither make threats of violence nor yield to violent intimidation. The point being that it's two sides of the same coin. The more you yield to violent intimidation, the more you encourage people to use it.
Yes, that the Danish cartoons are a perfect example of that, because from the beginning, actions such as Yale University's action have fed into the whole construction of them as being dangerous. And Vestergaard, who was the only one of the 12 cartoonists to actually speak up, contrary to the advice of Danish police, was in part singled out because he was the only one who spoke up. So there's a lot of serendipity in the way that this whole episode has evolved. And Anwar al-Awlaki and Osama bin Laden didn't have an opinion about the cartoons until after all of these things occurred. All of these things happened to make the cartoons emblemic of the sort of things Westerners say or do about Muslims, and that has then in turn made them dangerous symbols.
Do you have any sympathy, though, with a university administrator or the head of a university press, who says, "Well, look, even if the risk is very, very small, I have a responsibility for the safety of my employees, and even if the risk is tiny, and I have to weigh that against the public good and the academic value of publication."
Yes, I do have sympathy. I think universities have a custodial responsibility. And I did agree under duress, but I did agree to remove the Danish cartoons from the book. But I never agreed to the removal of the reproduction of an Ottoman manuscript or the removal of a depiction of made by Gustave Doré, that was also taken out. These are common images, they're part of what the art history, the art legacy of both the Muslim world and the Christian world. And to take them out is just an extraordinary act of self-censorship. These are images that have absolutely never been implicated in any demonstration, any protests whatsoever.
You mean the depictions of the, because I actually have the original sheaf of illustrations here. You mean the depiction in an Ottoman manuscript and the depiction in Gustave Doré's illustration for Dante's Divine Comedy,
Yes, that's correct.
for example.
Yeah.
Now, I've drawn on this conversation from an interview you gave to Index on Censorship. Soon after this story broke, and it was, of course, reported in the New York Times and elsewhere. Index on Censorship, however, themselves decided not to reproduce the page from Jyllands-Posten, the cartoons. And I have in front of me the statement from the chair of the trustees and also a protest from one of the trustees, Kenan Malik.
Yes.
How did you feel about that?
It was just a parody. It was becoming a comedy. Just a comedy of errors, really. Fear is very contagious, obviously. And the once you have somebody as established and well regarded as Yale University saying that this is too dangerous for us to do, then apparently, without any evidence whatsoever, everybody else decides that they need to be afraid too. It really became a moral panic. There was an exaggerated, inflated sense of a risk.
So, in a way, to rephrase it, you think that, as it were, panic in what we might broadly call the West, in Europe and North America, actually reinforced these hysterical and extreme reactions?
Yes, and by 2010, a year later, Anwar al-Awlaki, who has now been killed by in a drone attack by the U.S., speaking out of Yemen, published a very glossy magazine called Inspire Magazine, and created a hit list of people who were, Western Muslims ought to attack and kill. Because they insulted Islam. So that became, some people have described Anwar al-Awlaki as a pop Islamist. It became part of a new wave, really, of threats that had not originally existed. But by turning these cartoons into very singular images and having only a few people like Vestergaard being held responsible for them, we actually, I think, inadvertently continue to make Vestergaard's life very difficult and make him a central target for these sort of threats, which were publicity stunts. Anybody can issue a threat via the internet, The question is, how credible were these threats? And I think that's one of the things that no institutions have really found a good way of dealing with. The fact that a threat on the internet is a very different thing from having an active death threat from somebody in your backyard, but there's no ability really to distinguish between these very generalized threats. And as a result, the threat level has just proliferated. It's just there are just many more people who are constantly subject to threats.
And do you mean to say by that in some sense we shouldn't give these internet threats as much credibility as we do give them?
We should not. The Danish police decided at the time of the original incidents back in the fall of 2005 and 2006 that one of the criteria for having a credible threat was that there had to be proximity. You can't kill anybody unless you're close by. So proximity by itself was an operative.
But surely somebody might be proximity to the screen, in the sense that people can be radicalized online, can they not?
That's quite rare. It takes quite a lot to go out and attack a person. It takes a great deal of preparation. It's not just usually something the history of this sort of violence is not that people sit in front of the screen and then immediately stand up and pick up an axe and go and attack somebody. There was an attack on Kurt Vestergaard with an axe. So this is a real example. It happened in January 2010, I think, or 2000, yeah, New Year's 2010. And this was a person who already was under surveillance, but escaped the surveillance. So, of course, that is the issue that you have with surveillance. It's not always perfect. There, mistakes happen. But all of this happened subsequently to what has been going on with my book, and it's very different to sit and publish an academic book that's and being the original author of this so-called insulting cartoon. So I think that we have to make distinctions also between generalized academic debate. Actually, in Islam, even if you were of the mindset that you think that these are not publishable images, you are allowed to reproduce insulting images in the pursuit of discussing the nature of the insult. There's a religious opinion. I actually have a fatwa in my favor for the reproduction of the images.
Issued by whom, the fatwa?
The fatwa is by a Jordanian ulama, a learned scholar in Jordan.
That's very interesting indeed. Issued in response to the controversy around the book?
A friend of mine asked for a fatwa for a religious opinion.
Mm. Even in his understanding of Islam, and of course these understandings are contested,
yes,
there is, so to speak, theological justification in Islamic jurisprudence,
yes,
for the publication even of offensive images in order for them to be discussed.
Yes, this goes, I think, back to your principles that you have articulated, that there can be no taboos. I think it's important to recognize that the intent of the publication and speech matters.
Yes, yes, indeed, because there should be no taboos in the discussion and dissemination of knowledge, I mean, that's,
yes,
specifically in that case. What's been the subsequent publication history of your book? Has it been translated into languages of majority Muslim countries?
No, it has not. But I have sold the book, and in both, particularly in Turkey. One of my previous books was translated into Turkish. There was an effort to translate it and find a Turkish publisher for it. It didn't happen. I sent copies of the book to people in Cairo associated with Islam Online, which is a website linked to Sheikh Yusuf al-Qaradawi, widely regarded as the spiritual inspiration for the Muslim Brotherhood.
Yeah.
They read it, set up an international chat room for an hour with me, where people were calling in, emailing in to Cairo, where there was a bank of computers that then fielded the questions to me, and I sat in Boston and answered them. And I have had really nothing but understanding and open discussion with you, also with Islamists, about the intentions of my book.
Because can I just stop you there?
Mm-hmm.
Because what you just said is quite remarkable. This was in 2010?
Yes.
So we're talking a time when the Muslim Brotherhood is still formally banned in
yes.
Cairo. But
yes.
They are organizing from Cairo?
Yes.
A call-in discussion with you about your book?
That's right. A FedEx the book to Cairo.
And were some of the responses in that chat, online chat, with organized by the Muslim Brotherhood, very hostile?
A few were quite hostile, but we could talk about it.
Yeah, yeah. What was your attitude to the question of the republication of the cartoons themselves in newspapers? I don't mean initially when they were just the cartoons published by Ulandsposten. I mean when they had become the subject of this global controversy.
Well, I found that somewhat problematic because when all the newspapers in 2006 across Europe started republicizing the cartoons, they did it as a statement of solidarity with the Danes. That was a good instinct, but the problem that occurred was that it became a political movement that turned the cartoons into a political issue. This is what we do and this is what you do. And that type of confrontational action and reaction is not conducive to dialogue.
Wasn't it, by your own account in the book, the group of Danish and other imams who had turned it into a political?
It was, but there was an incredible ping-pong effect, and it was really quite remarkable the extent to which these cartoons became celebrities.
Yeah.
And that reinforced the sense that there was no bridge of opinion.
Could I put a counter argument to you, because which my own position is roughly this, that there was no good reason to republish the cartoons initially. It was just a little experiment made by one Danish newspaper.
Right.
But when they had become the subject of violent intimidation, which at a certain point they did become,
yes,
then the argument changes, and there was an argument for everybody to publish them simply to show that violent intimidation cannot pay.
I agree, yes, there was. But right now is when we really should be publishing them. And now nobody's publishing them anymore.
Yes, although it is, of course, true that you can go on Wikipedia and see them.
Yes. Yes.
Anytime.
Wikipedia actually has been subject to very significant pressure to take them down. And
from?
Yes, and they have kept them up. I think Wikipedia deserves a lot of credit for that.
Pressure from?
Both a write-in complaint, but I can't really say that much about it because I can't really verify it, but apparently also some official pressures.
Right. Well, we better ask them.
Yeah.
So, Jutta Clausen, coming to a close, what from this really extraordinary and depressing experience of yours, which starts with trying to write a very sober, academic, serious analysis of the whole controversy, what conclusions do you draw for our approach to freedom of expression?
I think it's very important to keep in mind that when you suppress something like the illustrations in my book, and here I'm speaking about them broadly, not just the Danish cartoons, but also the other images, you are taking something away from readers. You are denying access to important information. And by denying that access, you shut down dialogue. You have contributed to the very hostile perceptions in black and white of what the meaning was of these cartoons. And that is just not doable in international global societies where we have many different views. By farming out the decision about what is permissible standards to imagined threat from abroad, and imagine there was no actual threat to them, you have imported unknowable boundaries for what we can say and what we can talk about. And there is that happened in 2009, and in 2010 this was an issue. But it also means that now when I assign the book to my students and other people assign the book to students or anybody else wants to look up the cartoons, we are restricted access to diversity of opinion about the meaning of these cartoons.
Jutta Clausen, thank you very much for talking to Free Speech Debate.
Thank you.